In this video, we are going to give you some scary facts, some crazy government secrets, stuff on atomic bombs you never heard about, and finally, some very important information that may seriously affect your health. In 1938, German scientists discovered that uranium atoms could be split, releasing energy. With this new scientific information, the U.S. government realized they could create powerful atomic bombs. This is also maybe one of the reasons why just 3 days after the Nazi Germans surrendered, the U.S. government hired hundreds of Nazi war criminal scientists under the U.S. classified Operation Paperclip, which contributed to our space, nuclear, military, and technology programs. A company called Eldorado operated the Canadian Great Bear Lake uranium ore mine. This town name was eventually changed to Radium Port and later the town of Widows, because most people died of radiation poisoning. The men would hand carry 90-pound unprotected radioactive burlap sacks full of uranium ore from the mine to be loaded onto boats. The native women would recycle these burlap sacks into tents, clothes, and blankets for the men and children. Neither the Canadian government, Eldorado, nor the U.S. government warned these once fishermen natives of radiation dangers. This is similar to what the top secret classified U.S. government did to many of our neighborhoods, one being Cleveland, Ohio. Uranium was transported many times by untapped rail cars through farmlands, towns, and cities. For the sake of numbers, if you have 125 train cars full of coal, you can lose up to 15 tons of coal dust for every 500 miles traveled. Uranium ore, waste byproducts, and many other chemicals may have been similar. Maybe this is why we have higher cancer rates near rails. For every 500 pounds of uranium ore or yellow cake, you only produce 1 pound of usable uranium metal. To make this crazier, out of this 1 pound, you might get 1 ounce of weapons-grade plutonium or enriched uranium, which is what they use to make the atomic bombs. Even Einstein tried to stop this with a letter to President Franklin Delano Roosevelt. The letter dated March 25, 1945 was never opened because FDR died on April 12, 1945. On August 6th and 9th of 1945, President Truman dropped on Hiroshima the 9,000-pound Little Boy bomb and Nagasaki the 10,000-pound Fat Man bomb, which killed a combined 250,000 people and hundreds of thousands affected with birth defects, cancer, and other illnesses decades to follow. This Japanese killing machine was known as the top secret classified Manhattan Project, which employed 130,000 people at numerous sites. One of these sites was the designated top secret classified and still to date radioactive, the Harshaw Chemical Company, located in Cleveland, Ohio at 1000 block Harvard Avenue, which is still standing today. From 1942 through 1959, 1,500 workers refined uranium. Some reports indicate that this Cleveland plant discharged 4,000 pounds of radioactive uranium fluoride dust particles into the air. It is possible that 60,000 pounds of radioactive dust blew downstream throughout the Cleveland Flats and into the Cuyahoga River. Furthermore, it is alleged that radioactive yellow cake may have been stored near or on the Cuyahoga River bank. I remember growing up 40 years ago when the Cuyahoga River was highly contaminated, with most fish dying and the river catching fire on numerous occasions. This was a time that Lake Erie was dying and being severely polluted. Since this Manhattan Project was classified, it was like Sergeant Schultz. I know nothing. I remember about 25 years ago inspecting a home located at West 13th Street up on a hill, which is roughly 300 yards from Harshaw. I remember my client telling me that the previous owner had died of cancer. During the Harshaw plant's operation, where did they dump all the uranium tailings and the radioactive waste? I'm quite sure that these records may be rather hard to find. Additionally, someone tore down most of the Harshaw buildings on this 40-acre site. Why is concrete rubble on the Harshaw hillside and lying in the river? Where did they dump this debris? Why is the land on the other side of the river gated and padlocked? Recently, they just built the Steelyard Commons Strip Center, which is roughly 1,300 yards away. What did they do with all the soil they removed or scraped from the surface to build the strip center development? What is that huge pile of soil doing behind Target? If I had a lot of contaminated dirt, I would just pile it up on a big pile, and I'd let the wind slowly blow it away. I bet the Steelyard HVAC rooftop units and air intakes get plugged up with dirt and dust. Why are five buildings still standing at the Harshaw Chemical Plant with double fences and signs that read, "Danger, radioactive"? If our Pinocchio government did not keep secrets and lie, I might not be asking these questions. It is alleged that the federal authorities placed Harshaw in a Superfund cleanup program and paid out more than $5.5 million to former workers who were contaminated. The Army Corps released an assessment of Harshaw in April 2001, 2006, and 2009, which ultimately concluded that there remains no imminent threat to human health or the environment at the site. So why was the $85 million Ohio Canal Corridor's towpath trail bike path stopped at the Harshaw Chemical Plant? I guess we should just believe the EPA and our government because they know what is best for the people, or should I say sheeple. So let's not even worry about the americium 241, cesium 137, europium 152, 154, lithium, kerosene, neptunium, plutonium 238, plutonium 239, 240, tectonium 99, uranium 233, 234, 235, 236, 238, radium 226, radium 228, thorium 228, and thorium 230, or even their radioactive half-lives, which can last our children's children's children to the ninth power life. As I drive by the 100 Harvard property and see two special operation guards that park their black SUVs in front of one of these buildings, or they sit inside on the second floor because one light is always on, you wonder, what did they tell them?